The world is changed.
I feel it in the water. I feel it in the earth. I smell it in the air. Much that once was is lost, for none now live who remember it.
It all started the day that I, Meriwether Lewis, met Mr. Thomas Jefferson. A meeting with this great man was to change my life and my country forever. I could never have been prepared for my role in one of the greatest adventures in human history. Ever since I was a young boy, the wilderness had always called to me. My mother taught me to identify herbs and wildlife in our home in Georgia. My father died when I was very young, so it was up to me to learn to hunt and to fish. Often, I would venture out in the darkness of a cold winter night in search of game with only my dog for company. God has given America a beautiful land, rich in natural wonders. Seems now as if destiny was preparing me then for the trials later in my life. After a time with the local Virginia militia, I joined the United States Army. I rose in rank quickly, and I eventually caught the attention of the White House. On March 6th, 1801, I was asked to be the personal aide to our president, Thomas Jefferson.
Somebody who could take any who could be relied on for any undertaking, no matter its size or importance.
Ah, you've flattered me, sir. But with that sort of build-up, I'm quite wary of what you would ask of me.
Spent much time in the wilderness, Lewis? I heard you know the ways of the back country.
Yeah, you heard correctly. I've spent many a night out in the woods with naught in my belly but rabbits and roots. I'm quite at home in the back country.
I have great need of a man such as you.
Dear William Clark, a most extraordinary thing has happened to me. Our President Jefferson has commissioned a Corps of Discovery, meant to shed light on America's newly acquired territory in the West. He has named me to head this expedition. Such an enormous task cannot possibly be completed by a single man. I ask you, my brother in arms, to accompany me on this expedition. I will be overseeing the construction of a keelboat in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Please send your response there, as I will depart upon the morrow. I understand that this is very much to ask of any man. I will think no less of you if you decide not to come with me. Your friend, Meriwether Lewis. I knew not whether William Clark would be willing to accompany me on this grand adventure. Even when President Jefferson asked me, I was taken aback by the enormous responsibility that was placed upon me. Fortunately, however, my gauge of Clark's fearlessness and hunger for adventure proved accurate. After the construction of our keelboat, I sailed down the Ohio River and found him awaiting me with our band of recruits and supplies.
It's good to see that your courage has not deserted you, friend.
Oh, I'm more surprised to see you here. I half assume that your stay at the White House will have made you a fat politician.
Oh, far from it. I have shared my, I've had my share of formal dinners during which I've stuffed myself with suckling pig and roast duck, but I will never lose my love of adventure.
I reckon we'll have our share of adventures to tell up when we get back. I've heard stories of vicious Indian tribes, cannibals, giant sloths, and cities of gold.
Well, whatever we find out there, word of it must get back to Washington. We are to collect any new samples of plants or animals and send it straight back to Mr. Thomas Jefferson.
Well, let's hope we don't find any giant sloths.
So really, it could be said that we were headed on a proverbial highway to what could be called a zone of danger.
Our journey started off without significant event. The lands that we sailed past were not significantly different than the ones that we knew from back home. Rolling hills filled with green pines and oak lined the river. The songs of the birds and the other sounds of the wild were familiar to every man there. The company was in good spirits, as the days were cool and the nights were not yet freezing. Days spent sailing downstream were easy on the body, and the men were happily at ease. If only the rest of our journey were that easy. It was not long until we came to and crossed the mighty Mississippi River. Keeping track of the days in my journal, I found out that we were quickly approaching a momentous event. Our company soon came to celebrate the first 4th of July ever celebrated west of the Mississippi River. To honor this most momentous event, we set off a cannon. Yeah.
Men. We have been instructed to foster amiable relationships with any of the Indian tribes that might be in this area. I would have you treat them as you would treat any other man. Remember, this is their land and we are their guests.
We come in peace and friendship. We would like to talk to your leader.
Your presence has long been known. You may not be silent, traveler. You are welcome to come as long as you stay home. I have been instructed to come here, talk with you, see what you have.
I'm the leader of this company. I'd be proud to welcome you to a council.
As representatives of our people, we accept your invitation.
Today marks a historic day in the events of the United States of America. Today marks the first relations between the great United States of America and the Western Indian tribes. I hope to foster strong relations with you, and may it grow in the years to come.
We too hold the same hopes for the future. Our people may be different, but we hope that we can peacefully coexist.
Let it be known to all that the United States of America will remain firm in our relationship with you, unless it is not in our interest to do so.
Oh yes, that sounds great.
Wait a second.
We must be going now, but we will leave you with gifts. So that you may remember how much we love you.
Excellent. Just please, leave us some of your guns.
No. Guns are not gifts to be given to friends. We have medals and beads and other extra-sorty shiny things for you.
What need have we for...
Well, we really must be going. We got places to see, adventures to experience, and the Pacific Ocean to find. Come on, let's go.
Bye.
Bye. Wait.
The natives of this land seemed friendly enough. They welcomed us mostly with kind hearts. However, we could all sense an underlying sense of caution and distrust directed towards us. As our country expands westward, I must pause to think about what will happen to these people. That, however, is a challenge for future generations of Americans. Now, all we can do is blaze the way for further excursions into this most wild land. Around this time, we reach the vast plains that the natives had told us about. These great expanses of land are unlike anything else that we have seen before. Harsh winds blow across the prairie day and night. Like our European ancestors before the Atlantic crossings, we had to plunge into this great sea of grass without knowing what awaited us on the other side. We have encountered many new wonders in our travels. Just this today, we had an encounter with a strange new creature.
It went this way. I think it saw us scurry down the hole.
What do you think it was? I ain't seen nothing like that before.
Yeah, it was a long, skinny thing with massive teeth and horns.
No, it weren't. Didn't have no horns. It was like a squirrel, except without a bushy tail.
Whatever it was, we're getting it out of there. Fetch me some gunpowder.
Right away, Mr. Clark, sir, right away.
Matt, what are you doing with that gunpowder?
Well, we's gonna blow up that burrowing critter, see if it got no horns or not. Clark's orders.
Clark!
Yes, Lewis?
Okay. Do you honestly believe you will be able to blow up a mammal's burrow with a keg of gunpowder?
Maybe not.
Correct. Burrowing animals typically burrow deep underground to avoid predators like us. It will take at least 2 kegs of gunpowder to unearth it.
In hindsight, we probably shouldn't have wasted 5 kegs of gunpowder trying to get that animal out of its hole. When we finally blew its burrows to bits, we discovered that it was actually just a chipmunk. As fate would have it, though, later that day another man ended up catching a never-before-seen mammal. This strange creature was long and furry. The man said he saw a colony of them popping in and out of their burrows in the prairie. In that case, I believe that the name Prairie Dog would suit it well. I will preserve its body and send it back to Washington for examination. Also, gunpowder supplies are running low.
I wanna be the very best, like no one ever was. To catch them is my real test, to train them is my cause. I will travel across the land, searching far and wide, for hungry Pokemon to understand the power that's inside.
Pokemon, gotta catch 'em all.
It's you and me. I know it's my destiny.
Pokemon,
oh, you're my best friend.
In a world we must defend. Pokemon, gotta catch 'em all.
Our hearts so true. Our courage will pull us through. You teach me and I'll teach you.
Pokemon, gotta catch 'em all.
Gotta catch 'em all.
6.5 hours later.
I hear some rustling. Man one stands and looks around.
Don't read the stage directions. Who goes there?
White men, you are trespassing on the lands of the Teton Sioux. State your business and go back from whence you came immediately.
Okay now. We come in peace. We're just an exploration party. We didn't mean any harm at all to you or your people. But we will continue on the
here. This is not how we treat our guests. There must be some big misunderstanding here.
Father?
Now, singing chickadee, what did I tell you about the trespassers?
Go.
Your name is Wimpy.
But Father, you told me not to tolerate any trespassers and to kill them if they refuse to leave.
No. I only meant to keep out other tribes. Newcomers will always be welcome in the Sioux Nation.
Oh, really? But look what you've just...
You should stay with us for the night. It's awfully cold out on the prairie.
Thank you, Chief Black Buffalo. I'm sure your son didn't mean any harm. He was only...
He's a silly boy.
He was only following the orders he thought that you gave him, but apparently not.
Now let us feast together to show the world that we are friends.
We stayed with the Sioux for 4 days. The ways of these Plain Indians were vastly different from the tribes that we had encountered in the East. These people had not yet experienced the oncoming tide of white settlement. While they did not yet know to be wary of us, I sensed that our expedition will bring them into contact with more and more settlers. The culture of these people may be primitive, but I hope that they can still retain their ways in the future.
Loki'd!
Oh, bonjour, bonjour! I am Toussaint Charbonneau, a Canadian trapper. It's good to see you.
Oh, good to see you too. We are a traveling party. We are exploring this land. We seek shelter. Winter is coming.
Oh, white people, thank God!
Hello, bonjour, bonjour, bonjour. Oh, excuse me. This is my wife, Sacagawea. As you can see, she is pregnant. Oh, she sends her greetings and also says this is one big freaking baby. You are welcome to stay as long as you like, and the winter keeps you, of course.
Charbonneau seemed very interested in our expedition, and he offered his knowledge as a trapper and trader familiar with the region. Besides that, he is a man of no particular merit. One of his squaws, by the name of Sacagawea, who is heavily with child, speaks Shoshone, a language we will need when we encounter that tribe. She also has an extensive knowledge of the wilderness and survival in this country. In mid-February, Sacagawea gave birth to a boy, whom his father named Jean-Baptiste Charbonneau, and Clark nicknamed Bumpy. Clark. He is to accompany us as far as his mother. Such strength I have not often seen before in a woman. Even a squaw. When April came, we packed up and continued to the west, now with a greater party than before.
Looking out over these mountains makes you realize God put these here for men to see, for men to climb. We've already been the first to climb the one below our feet. Will you help me climb these as well?
You're beginning to sound like a president, Clark.
That's the spirit of adventure speaking. It's the only thing keeping me from going like the Canadian here.
Oh, I'm so tired. I just want to go home. Water, Stevie. Water.
Well, let's hope that the same spirit can take us all the way to the Pacific Ocean.
I'm so tired.
You know what?
I
want
to go back to Ontario.
I would like to propose a new policy for the Corpse of Discovery.
Canada.
All whiners are eaten.
What? He does look rather tasty.
How rude!
Well, our small water crafts are great for our purposes, but it seems that some have more prowess with them than others. Once we almost lost a set of very valuable journals and newly discovered specimens to the rushing waters, but the squaw Sacagawea was quick enough to save them. We might just name this river after her. In August, we finally reached the headwaters of the Missouri, and were pleased to find a peaceable tribe living there.
Many months later.
These months in the Rocky Mountains have been the hardest. We lost our two bumbling extras to the elevation frosts, and our food rations are dreadfully low. We have resorted to eating the less essential and technically edible objects from our supplies. Morale is low and tensions run high.
Croissant à la mode, s'il vous plaît, mon chéri, escargot!
Hey, wait, hey, whoa! That's not how we treat people in the American wilderness. You better stop or I'm gonna leave.
Finally, we reached what seemed to be the top of the world, and the end of these mountains. It seemed we would find that river to the Pacific, and a smooth ride there and back. Instead, as we reached the peak, I spied only more mountaintops and no sign of the ocean we sought. We continued even further west across the mountains to the Pacific Ocean. Charbonneau, that coward, abandoned our party about halfway to the coast. Luckily, as Clark suspected, he was quite tasty.
The next step I take, Lewis, will be the farthest I've ever been from home.
Very nice.
Hold my glasses.
Okay.
It's the ocean! It's the Pacific Ocean!
Hooray!
Come on in!
Why not?
It's so expansive!
Oh,
it's so
beautiful!
It's so wonderful!
Pacific!
I've been looking forward to
Impressive.
This! I packed these trunks just for this occasion!
Oh, joy!
Zach and Joanne, join us! What are you...
So much joy!
Save the baby!
So much later that the old narrator got tired of waiting, and they had to hire a new...
We made our way back east, where President Jefferson rewarded us well. I was made governor of the new Louisiana Territory. Clark was designated as the United States agent to the Indians in the West. Sacagawea stayed in the East to help build herself a family. Charbonneau, well, we didn't actually eat him. We just killed him and left him for the condors. No, we didn't actually do that either. We just left him. We have no idea where he is. First row, Clark!
I also can't zoom during a video. Like, I have to zoom before or after a video.
Really? That is crap.
It's very crap. I had a better camera, but it needs an HD memory card, and I don't have one. Behind the scenes, there's a pile of crap in that room. I can't zoom on it because this camera's crap. Don't do it!
Taylor!
Yeah. Alec! Take off the buckskin, please! Are you recording?
Yeah.
Okay. Behind the scenes! This is my hair!
Actually, no, here was my original idea. I'm in the center, and we have two people off screen. They throw it to one, I'm like,
yeah! Yeah.
Like, monkey in the middle sort of thing, and then finally I, like, run it down and catch it.
Yeah! I was thinking you have two people off screen like playing catch, except like the first time they throw it and Cam's chasing it, and the second time Cam runs and they throw it at him, sort of. Like, yeah. It's like it's chasing him. It's like turned around.
Yeah,
Yeah.
The T-Rex?
I don't know.
No, that lizard I
have. Oh, it's in mine.
I mean, it's your video.
Guys, and then for this one, we could just like put it somewhere in the grass. I could be like just running and jump like I caught it with the T-Rex, and then hold it up by its tail.
Do you have a Pokeball?
It's...
Very feisty.
I do not have a Pokeball. The closest thing I have is like a little picture of a Pokeball. But, yeah. Let's go, Lewis.
Uh-huh.
Adventure. You're not supposed to talk. You ruined the scene. Wonder why. Up river. Follow Lewis. Keep marching. We want like footstep noises.
Hakuna Matata.
What a wonderful phrase.
Hakuna Matata. Passing craze. It means no worries. Sing it, kid.
Philosophy, Hakuna Matata.
Why are you?
Because I'm recording, that's why.
Damn it!
I was recording. Why else would I start singing, Amar?
I thought we were just singing for the hike.
No.
What scenes are we filming now?
We told you to play with the baby and forage.
I'm casting this spell on it.
On it or us, we're the ones that you're guiding, Sacagawea. The Frenchman has it. Historical inaccuracy. You were not Tituba. No! No! Baby! Save the baby! Save the baby!
It makes him live harder.
Live harder?
Live harder.
But YOLO. Good job.
Achilles!
She can speak? And she knows the Iliad? What is this? I'm
going to
go into the ocean.
Hi, ho, Lewis.
And Clark here.
Well, you might have been wondering why half of our company was made up of scarecrows. You see, the thing about scarecrows, you don't have to pay them that much. And, you know, being scarecrows, they are brave. They are brave. They're meant to scare other people. That means they are extremely brave on themselves. They're not going to run away from any fight. Those scarecrows, they could take on a honey badger.
Yeah.
Really. Like, fearless beasts they are, fearless beasts. You saw that guy get shot with an arrow, you didn't see him scream at all. I mean, he was all calm and sitting there, and he's just like, oh.
Oh, there's an arrow in my chest / leg / skull.
Yeah.
It might have been 3 arrows, I forget.
Might have been. It was one of those special arrows. Those natives, you don't know what they're doing out there.
Tricky.
They're weapon specialists, you don't know what they got out there. They have these arrows to shoot and split into three, and they can kill a man like that, but not a scarecrow. Those scarecrows can take it.
Nope. Yeah, and also along the journey, several times this big crow came out of nowhere. Scarecrow just stood up, looked it right in the eye. The crow flew away.
It scared him. It's amazing.
Saved our whole company so many times.
That's why we bring him. That's why, right?
Yep.
Right.
I owed that scarecrow my life.
Yep. You don't have to feed them nothing either. They're all fighting side.
Very inexpensive workers.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah. Although you can't eat them if they die.
Yeah.
You see, like, that's humans. You have to feed them, but like if they die because they starve, you can eat them after. I mean, it's
exactly.
It's
yeah.
like the circle of life or something.
Something yeah. like that.
Something like
their
that.
Their bodies become the grass.
Yeah, yeah.
And the antelope eat the grass.
Exactly. But if you can't digest the grass, then you're just doomed.
Exactly.
Exactly.
And the scarecrows themselves are made out of grass.
Exactly. So they do fit into the circle of life.
I'm sorry
about that.
It's the lions, the antelopes, and the scarecrows.
Exactly. Exactly. And the crows. I mean, but the crows are...
They have their own little circle off to the side.
Yeah, it's more of a line, actually.
Yeah,
just
it's,
with,
it,
like, the crow and the scarecrow.
It's a bit like a Venn diagram with, like, the two... with a line going through it.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
So it's kind of like a weird graph.
Yeah, I see what you mean.
There might be a parabola in there.
You see the things we learned on this expedition? I mean, we were doing science all the way there.
So much science.
Yes, but...
Dropping science.
We're dropping down the science, really. You don't want to know how much you learned from this. I mean, we were natural historians.
Oh, my brain was ready to burst by the time
I know.
Into the ocean.
I know, really.
So much knowledge.
And all those things we sent back to Thomas Jefferson, we never did see any sloths, did we?
We did not find any giant sloths, but...
Who told you that story, really? Where did you hear that?
I might have been drunk, and he could have been talking about... I don't know, something that rhymes with sloths.
Moth.
Moths.
No, we saw some moths. Said moths, yeah.
We did send back a couple big moths.
We did. They were crazy.
Really nothing to call home about.
No.
Your garden variety, huge as your face moth.
Yeah. We saw lots of those. I mean, they're just vanilla moths.
Yeah, vanilla moths. No mods, no extra little things.
Yeah.
All right.
Okay.
Well, just a little commentary there.
Yeah.
This has been Clark.
And this is Lewis.
Bye.